Hello.
Hello, everyone.
Sorry, I always have issues with Zoom nowadays. One second.
Hello, hello.
All right, cool. Picked up the correct camera this time.
Oh, yeah, too comfortable with Google Meet now.
It's Google doesn't allow Zoom client, so I'm using the web browser all the time. And it's a struggle. Okay, I'm going to see what I can do to the recording. Pushka was able to do it the last time, so I don't know why he did different from me. All right, I still can't get it working. Sorry. We have to post it again after. Okay, let me bring up meeting notes, paste it in the chat. If everyone can put in your names and your affiliations, that'd be great. We'll need one who scribes of the day. So if you can put your name down in scribes and help scribe, that would be awesome. Just like taking note of action items. And today we have the cloud custodian security review. So lots of exciting discussion. So let's give it a couple of minutes to wait for more folks to join in. Emily, do you know if you're going to be our TOC liaison yet?
No decisions have been made. No one has been assigned. I believe that'll happen closer to like mid-March when we have the full sitting talk.
Okay. So is there another round of rotations going to happen?
We just have the talk selection member coming up.
I see. All right, we'll start at 105. Looks like we have Robert, Josh, and Kapil. So, the quorum for the review. All right, so I think let's get started. So standard procedure. Hello, everyone. Just a reminder, meeting is being recorded and it's going to be posted to YouTube after. Participation in meetings are to abide to the company security code of conduct as well as the stack code of conduct. We will need at least one person to volunteer a scribe to make sure that we capture all the action items. So if someone can volunteer for that, that'd be great. For existing members and working group representatives, make sure to include your organization company along with working group you're involved with in the update as part of the attendance. Cool. So before we jump right into the cloud custodian security review, I'm going to just go through a couple the usual. So do we have any new members here today? It doesn't look like it, I think. All right. TOC meeting updates. I think there was a TOC update last week. Was it last week or the week before? Any updates from there of interest? Guess not.
No, we're still figuring stuff out.
Okay, awesome. Cool. So next up, we're just going to go through some of the project groups, if they have any updates. So for the audio working group, supply chain working group, serverless, security pals, security reviews, controls, currently the security map or white paper. If you have any updates, could you just do a quick shout out? John, were you about to say something? We can't hear you if you are.
Nope. No updates from the control side. We're still chugging along. A couple more weeks there.
Cool.
From a serverless working group perspective, our white paper is ready. It's being technically edited. It'll be sent out by Andrew and Ashish to a limited audience or feedback first, and then we'll open it to the wider audience. They should be sending out the communication in a day or so.
Okay, will this be in the tag channel, or is it going to be on a mailing list, or where should we look for it?
I think it's a mailing list. It's a limited review right now, and then we'll open it up to the wider working group.
Awesome. Thanks, Aranda.
No worries.
All right. So just going to go through the list to make sure we don't have any, we see have any updates from people. Doesn't look like there are any updates. So I think let's just jump straight into the...
Quick question though. We had that conversation with Nest, right, on a SSDF?
Yes.
I was just wondering, what are the next steps there in addition to the cloud native security white paper? What we need to add there? We need to work with the cloud controls, the controls working group, to map out SSDF and 800-53 then. Just trying to figure that out.
Yeah, so I think just to give some context, we met up with NIST to talk about, you know, the SSDF, the different documents that they are giving out with guidance to folks, and how that will kind of map into some of the work that we're doing with the cloud native security white paper, as well as the controls, like Aranda said. So I think there are a few things, right? I think with the cloud native security white paper is going to be working on the additional content for now. I think we still have to look at the template that NIST has provided us. So NIST has provided us with a controls mapping template to talk a little bit more about, okay, this is what the control is, how does it map onto this particular technology or process, and for example, what are some of the documents that are used to show this process. So I think right now, based on our discussion last time, we have to evaluate that to determine whether it is going to be helpful or whether we need to add any more things to the template in order to move towards OSCO, right?
Sure, Brandon. Let's have an offline discussion on how to make progress on that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Cool. All right, if not, let's jump right ahead to the review. So who's going to be driving this? Is it going to be Robert, George, Kapil?
Well, I'm happy to share my screen, and I think it's going to be from the hip. I didn't realize this was scheduled until this morning. So, and I know George and Kapil had requested doing some sort of prep session before this, but I think just, I'm happy to go through it ad hoc. And then if Kapil and George want to chime in or comment on their view of the process.
Let's do it live.
Yeah, we'll make it up.
Let's do it.
So I'm just happy to share. Can everyone see my screen? It's the joint review.
Looks good.
Okay, fantastic. So just to give everyone a background, Cloud Custodian has been super, super patient in this process. Kapil and team initially engaged us, I want to say maybe it was early 2020, maybe it was even earlier than that, while this group was figuring out the assessment process and what was the scope and why should projects go through it. And so they kind of, I think, caught us during these various transitions and trying to define the process. And so it kind of went in fit and starts, and we did an initial review. We asked them for self-assessment, and you know, over the next 12 months, we kind of, things got restarted and then paused again and restarted. So I think the lesson, you know, the top level lesson learned is best to kind of define a very time box scope for everyone, especially recognizing that people have lots of, you know, parallel projects and, you know, day jobs and various other things that are going to draw people off of the project. I guess my advice to leads on this is to really time box it and say, like, we're going to start on this date, we're going to end on this date. And if, you know, those requirements aren't met, the people aren't available, then, you know, it gets pushed on the backlog until someone, all of the someone's involved, both from the project side and from the tag side, can commit to that. But that's just my own personal suggestion. So just talking about Cloud Custodian itself, it's a configuration policy and runtime check tool. Allows the operator of, you know, whatever cloud infrastructure, be it Amazon or Azure or Google Cloud, or even, you know, a particular component like Kubernetes, to define a series of checks on the various configurations that are required to meet what you could call a policy check. I think for those of us who work in the policy domain, where policy means many different things, I would say it's more like a configuration baseline, configuration standard check. It can be run on the command line. It's essentially a Python tool. And I think the team has done a great job embedding that into the various cloud function as a service features. So you can run it on AWS as a Lambda. You can run it on Azure as a function, I believe. And I'm guessing, I haven't tried this myself, but you can probably run it as a Kubernetes pod. And then you generate, you write some YAML files that define what resources and what checks you want to perform. And then it produces an output. So as we looked at this, it was an interesting, from an assessment perspective, how do you assess something that essentially is 100% a snapshot point in time versus, okay, like a running service that's a daemon and, you know, a stateful and kind of running all the time. This is really, it's a utility. It's a tool that you run on the command line or the equivalent of that in a cloud infrastructure. And so where is the boundary for this, right? So, you know, what argument number one could be, the boundary is really the DevOps user's machine. And that's it, right? If their machine is secure, then they're running this command like any other command. Or if it's running as a function on the cloud infrastructure, then it's really just, you know, have you followed best practices for running those functions and setting the right IAM policies? I think we expanded the scope a bit more to include the supply chain, if you will. You know, how is the project set up in GitHub? Are they checking dependencies? Are they checking vulnerabilities? And then we heavily relied on the CII best practices. You know, are they following those? Have they provided the information for that? And that's largely how we evaluated their security posture. And I'll just kind of, you guys can review all this on the repo. And then maybe George and Kapil can jump in with a little bit more flavor and nuance in the description. But I'll just highlight, you know, target users. You know, obviously you've got the operators who are, you know, trying to assess their overall infrastructure and service, kind of at that enterprise level. and give like a holistic view of, you know, am I configured securely? And over time, am I drifting from a secure baseline? You know, quota is, again, more, you can write checks that aren't security checks. So they can be, you know, am I running resources I shouldn't? Are those resources sized appropriately? Am I cost getting under control? I think you could, you know, integrate this with third-party tools and kind of make it part of your, you know, holistic security program. And then, you know, if you're trying to build a platform, you know, I think, you know, across many CNCF projects or across Kubernetes and various CNCF projects, this could be a very, you know, foundational security component where you've got a comprehensive view across clouds, across projects of, you know, how is my baseline configuration defined, and then how am I evaluating that, you know, periodically and transactionally for a particular security query, and then again that drift, how do I monitor drift over time? I think this is a summary. I can't recall if this was our summary or provided by the project, but I think you should definitely review all the kind of features that it enables and all of the infrastructure APIs that it calls. I mean, from a GRC, from a risk assessment perspective, I see this as a very valuable tool, kind of mapping, you know, where that difficult challenge of mapping a compliance goal or a security goal at a high level, human policy level, down to the nitty gritty of how do I query my infrastructure? How do I query the jobs and the pods and the resources and the data stores that are being deployed? And this is kind of where the rubber hits the road for me, using a tool like this to gather all that data. And they've got, you know, it's a very robust, very proven project. It's been used at very large enterprises. So all of the accoutrement of, you know, caching and performance and reliability, it all seems to be there. I've used it myself. I've deployed it in AWS. So I had some familiarity with some of those operational requirements, but it is very user-friendly. If you've never used it before, you can get up to speed in a few hours. And then if you need to deploy it at scale in a large enterprise across clouds, it's a very, you know, it's a few days of effort and a lot of examples and a lot of third-party articles and blogs on how to use it. And here's a nice overview of all the different components to using it, again, in a fully operationalized mode. You could use it as a command line, provide it some of the configuration checks in the YAML, and you know, you would get a result very quickly. But if you're operationalizing this to run automatically, periodically, these are the kind of things that you would want to look at. I think we'll just skip through the configuration. I think foundational to our review was that they had done a very comprehensive threat model. It was a little, you know, by the time we, as I mentioned, got through the starts and pauses, it was a little dated, but it was absolutely usable as provided and was really the basis for most of our discussions. This was a little grid that I put together. I think it's modeled after a NIST IR 8011, I think, but it's a kind of a framework that NIST had put out for mapping on one axis, you know, kind of the MITRE-like attack steps, and then on the y-axis, kind of the capabilities that you would put in your security program. I'll note that red here, so we identified this as a risk, not so much that the code for a cloud custodian or the project is risk, it has a risk that needs to be remediated, but more as the user of cloud custodian, where do I want to put my focus on the, you know, using it in a production environment, right? So, I'll drill down into some of these areas below, but, you know, just to kind of highlight, for example, you know, you're taking this on as an open source component. So, you know, you're responsible for, you know, reviewing changes and updates as they come through. Otherwise, you're just accepting that as trusted. Where we've seen, of course, in the real world, some attacks have come through open source projects where changes are inserted and maybe not reviewed where they should be. You know, as a Python project, it has some third-party dependencies. You know, as the operator, you're kind of inheriting that risk yourself. So you need to make sure that you understand the dependencies they pull in and are monitoring those vulnerabilities and so on and so forth. So they, as a project, have taken, you know, a lot of steps around the integrity of their packaging on GitHub and the security checks and following the CI best practices. So we felt that that was essentially something that you could put some trust in. We talked about a little bit, you know, so how would I see Cloud Custodian from an attacker's perspective? You know, ultimately, as something that's going to be reviewing your entire cloud infrastructure, that you know, I want to see that as a vector to both discovery and understanding all the resources and all the configurations. Even if I can't modify anything, it gives me a very good view. I mean, the exact same view the enterprise operator wants, the attacker wants, right? So I can start planning further attacks. As an insider, even more so, right? Because now I can really drill down and start to look at how I can obfuscate or hide things. You know, then I'd say from the administrator, the policy, maybe not attack is the wrong term, but there are a lot of mistakes you could make, right? Just user error, if you will, and defining the configurations and kind of getting a false sense of security. If you think something is secure and you think you map the policy correctly, and you think you set all the YAML properties correctly, but in, you know, in effect you didn't. And then, so you're kind of like letting it run and getting good results, but you're checking the wrong things, that type of thing. We talked about some of the things, you know, so as something that is going to be used in a real world environment, if I can compromise the environment, like, you know, either it was user error on the DevOps side and I misconfigured, I didn't follow the best practices, or there was some exploitable vulnerability in Cloud Custodian itself, you know, really allows a lot of opportunity for attackers to take advantage of that. So I can, you know, for example, I could do a denial of service and I could, you know, write policies or modify policies so that it constrains resources or wholesale deletes resources. I could, you know, do privilege escalation. I could change, you know, various settings on these to open up more access than should be there. So, you know, it's a double-edged sword. There's a, you know, lot that you are doing to secure your infrastructure and surface configuration issues in your infrastructure. But if that can somehow be exploited, then, you know, all of those things are now weapons, if you will. So you can review those. Yeah, I think, we talked about some of these examples. So again, I think, you know, to use it effectively, you really kind of have to understand the underlying security controls on that cloud platform. And it's not a substitute for, you know, a cursory review of how you're securing your Lambdas, how you're using this, just like any other resource that you might deploy on AWS. We didn't really talk about, you know, the bootstrapping of, you know, how do you know that Custodian itself is a Lambda is we did say that the project might provide a little bit more out of the box bootstrapping information about kind of best practice policy, IAM policy on the AWS or the equivalent on Azure and other clouds. At the time, and you know, this was a few months ago now, there wasn't really prescriptive policy guidance there. And I think the project felt that it wasn't necessarily a best practice for them to define, here's how you should configure your cloud. And I totally appreciate that. I think as an operator though, just the reality is I want to start with something and kind of modify it. It's just, you know, cognitively easier to start with a template that I can tweak than to kind of look at a blank sheet of paper and scratch my head. So my suggestion still to the project, if this hasn't been done, would be to bolster some of those, you know, IAM policy examples. And here's how, you know, in reviewing how people are using it in the real world, here's how those tend to look. and give someone a starting point. I would highlight this again, you know, to get use out of custodian as an operator, you really have to give it read access to everything. And then, you know, if you want to use it for remediation or kind of drift prevention, you really have to start giving it write access. And at that point, you know, every permission you give it to make it useful to you becomes a permission that an attacker might exploit. We put some best practices. I will note that, you know, there's been a lot of work in other areas, not custodian specific, about, you know, encrypting, signing policies, SIGSTOR and things like that. So that might be something that's now a little bit more mature than when we first started looking at this, and the project might avail themselves of that. They may have started looking at that in the last few months since we did this evaluation. I think Emily helped us a lot on the Stride evaluation. So again, we've talked about some of the denial of service, or I think maybe the formatting is a little bad here. Maybe something got lost in the markup, but privilege elevation is obviously a concern. If you can exfiltrate the results from somebody's environment, that's going to be very useful kind of on the underground chats on how to do reconnaissance on an organization. Again, I think at the project level, George and Kapil can chime in if I've got that wrong. I don't think that they were doing kind of branch protection, multiple PR reviews or things like that. I think that would be useful just to have a little bit more confidence in the security code review process. One possible issue is if cloud custodian is configured to be too aggressive, it could just be continually querying things. Maybe that's an opportunity for denial of service attack. Kind of mapped it out here in a very simple kind of, we weren't using one of those tools like Mermaid. I think we've other folks on this call have probably come up with better tools to do the attack mapping, but this was just a quick visual of all the possible nodes, if you will, and the different attacks and how you might chain those together. There are probably better tools now out there that we should use for this type of analysis, but there was a quick attempt. We talked about the CIA badge attestations. I know we had connected Kapil and team with the CNCF effort to increase fuzzing. Might not apply to a Python project. I think that fuzzing effort is really focused more on the kind of Golang, maybe C code. I don't know if that discussion ever went anywhere, but if they have Python fuzzing capabilities, or if the project itself can invest a little bit in that, that's probably a good thing just to make, because that policy, those policy rules maybe open you up to some of those type of errors. We talked about, so if there is a process for sending them vulnerabilities, and there's an embargo process, I think we talked through, but it might need a little bit more clarity on the site documentation. Maybe this has been cleaned up since then. Don't think that's a major risk, but I think as the project grows and more people use it, it would be good to understand if there's enough people reviewing it and if they can respond quickly enough. So I know there was some chatter on Slack or others about, so there are vulnerabilities and maybe some of the third-party components and Python libraries. And so, you know, the question is, that's not really a vulnerability in custodian per se, but, you know, I think the operator should be aware that they need to scan. And obviously this was just a snapshot from September, so all of this is probably outdated already. I think everyone should just understand they have to own the supply chain like any other open source project. And so, so whether you're using the Docker image or downloading it yourself and using it in your own Python environment, and whether your Python environment has these vulnerabilities or the libraries that custodian is using, just don't assume that it's got no open CVEs until you go through the exercise yourself. We didn't do kind of a hands-on evaluation or any kind of code audit or, you know, what you might consider a traditional pen test. Again, the pen test idea doesn't really apply to something like a command line utility. It's not, even in a Lambda mode, it's just running a scheduled task essentially. So it's not waiting there listening for requests or anything like that. So, you know, pen test really wouldn't apply. I'd say code review, code, you know, if someone wanted to do a more detailed security code audit, that would, I'm sure the project would recommend, welcome that. And then of course, if you wanted to do more hands-on testing of, you know, how you construct security policies, what the results are there any kind of false positives or false negatives? I think that would just generally fall in the kind of QA testing for the project. And I'm sure that they would welcome that as well. We have a set of, I won't read through all these, but for those who are interested, I mean, you know, these are definitely wish lists. I'd say, you know, my pet suggestion, and again, you know, maybe Kapil and George have any updates, just, you know, from a CNCF selfish perspective, it would be great if there was more mature Kubernetes resource support or other CNCF projects. And maybe there are now, but at the time, I think that was still in its infancy. And yeah, I just would, you know, welcome the project to try to find fuzzing resources and apply that. Might lead to some interesting exploitable issues that wouldn't probably come out of kind of top-down testing. If there are CNCF or Linux Foundation, other internship available, to, you know, funding available or something like that, again, providing a little bit more of that best practice policy and more documentation on new users is always helpful. I don't know what the funding opportunities are, but if CNCF wants to get in the business of doing a more formal code audit, hands-on assessment, I think that would be highly recommended. And again, just my personal bias, if in a Kubernetes environment, I think that would be fantastic. And we got some great information from the project on who's using this today. So you should definitely review that. There are other choices out there. Some of the cloud tools have native, but I think, you know, Kapil can probably express, you know, the benefits of how some of those are very costly. Obviously, all of them are special to their particular cloud or project, like a KubeBench, so not very general purpose. And the ability to aggregate across your entire infrastructure and even across multiple clouds, I think, is very powerful. So very much there's a use case and a very solid place for Custodian, even compared to those other tools. So that's, anything else that you would add, Matthew? I think Matthew's on. Or maybe not. Matthew, are you on? I should call out, we should have a list of people who contributed. I apologize. Maybe I'll PR something, but we had a number of volunteers who helped. Matthew helped me. Really took most of the lead in setting up the meetings and coordinating. George and Kapil, of course, were critical to this effort. And I know I'm forgetting a ton of other people just because the process was over several months ago. But I will try to PR here and put an explicit list of thanks. Oh, here we go. Okay, so I don't have everybody's name mapped to their GitHub. And yes, Emily, thanks again for the stride and a lot of review work. Chase as well. So please, if I didn't mention you, I apologize, and I'll PR to this review list.
Awesome. Anything from Kapil and or George you want to add? I saw a bunch of comments as well in the chat.
Yeah, I think the one thing I am fairly thankful for coming out of the review process was discovering SemGrep, which is awesome as a tool, and we've now incorporated into our pipeline. There's a good amount of commentary here about IAM policies, and I realize that using written words can sometimes be misinterpreted. So I just wanted to clarify on, so custodian supports users bring whatever cloud credentials they want. The policies themselves mapped out to a very small, can be mapped out to a very fine grain setup. And that's what we document to enable that. The challenge has actually been the organizational side on the user side, where they don't, they can't keep up with the rate of their policy change to be reflective in their IAM. And so they end up using whatever makes sense for their use cases. And so, yeah, that tends to detract from what is a default policy. Well, if you're just doing your reporting, you just do read-only and you call it a day. But if you want to go fine-grained, it is possible and it is documented as far as what the permissions and are for each capability that's used in a policy. We do have branch protection. Don't know that I have a whole lot to add, but I'll definitely take any questions if there are. And George, I'll pass the mic.
I was going to mention on the Kubernetes support, we're kind of committed to doing that this year. It's just it was a matter of resourcing and hoping to have something by KubeCon. Knock on wood.
That's awesome.
Do you want to talk a little bit about how we plan to do that, Kapil? Or
sure. Kubernetes support, we're probably just going to do, like, we have basic Kubernetes support as far as the resources we want to add. An operator, we will probably use the Python framework cuff that came out of Zalando as an implementation detail that will allow for some degree of enforcement on policies. We will look at the CRD for policy violation reporting that we've seen come out of the Kubernetes policy group as well as a reporting output format. I think that's probably all there is on that topic. And I think it's generally worth noting people, some people use custodian primarily as checks. A lot of people use it as sort of real-time remediation just because they don't want the big wall of red. they want to pay it down, so to speak. And then we're also looking at some work as far as roadmap stuff on shift left and sort of integrating in policy enforcement earlier in the pipeline towards infrastructure assets as code before they're deployed.
So the Kubernetes work, is it an admission controller or is it going to be more at runtime?
It would just be an admission controller in that context. Sorry, what was the other? You mentioned the admission controller or something else?
No, I'm just asking, is it like admission control or is it after the things are deployed?
It would be an admission controller. Kubernetes benefits from being isomorphic, both on describe and definition. So an admission controller, one of our cardinal rules for policies is we have many different execution modes, but we want the policy to look the same. Mm-hmm. So we do a lot of work to normalize the data feeds per se, like AWS config versus a CloudWatch event rule. We normalize how config speaks spoke format or security hubs bespoke format. In this case, that part's relatively straightforward just because of the orthogonality or isomorphism with regards to Kubernetes definitions.
Cool, thanks. So for security advisories, are you planning to use GitHub to track your CVEs, or is that not under consideration at this point?
So we have a security team and a public mailing, a public email for that. As we haven't had any CVEs filed against the project itself. The email for CVEs against our dependency graph. We have a few things in play. We're currently using Dependabot as far as that goes, just for the dependency graph security updates. And then we regularly do a full rebase as far as our dependency graph that has gotten more interesting due to the size of the Azure dev graph, but on their SDK. But generally speaking, we are pretty minimal with regards to non-cloud provider dependencies. that are necessary for any given provider. I think we've had maybe 5 emails go through on the security side, none of which, I think the only one that came up with some regularity, because most of the time custodian gets deployed in enterprise environments that already have their own scanning tools. So we, I think PyAML had a default serialization possibility attack, and therefore everyone was flagging that version of the library, even though it wasn't something that custodian itself was per se vulnerable to. So knock on wood, nothing yet, but as far as managing the process itself on a disclosure, I think we would file out with CVE on the CVE database and a coordinated release. And interestingly enough, we have had a lot of reach out to, I mean, there are thousands of companies running custodian at scale. Like, we've had reach outs from the cloud providers with regards to particular feature upgrades that they knew were going to affect things. So we would potentially look to reverse that channel to go to them as far as getting users to upgrade. One of the common challenge in open source, how do you get everyone to upgrade, so to speak?
Awesome. By the way, since we're talking about this, there's a couple of weeks ago, we were talking about this exact issue, and one of our community members did write up a little bit on that. So I'm going to paste the issue in. And like, if you want to take a look at it, maybe if you want to add some comments as well, or just like see what is helpful. And the link to the HackMD documents, yeah. Try and get them to put it in the PR, but as of now, it's a HackMD document.
Yeah, I was definitely interested in doing, like, we have, like, PyPI itself, Google sponsorship infrastructure to directly expose CVEs to their API. We've also been looking at Cosign as potentially a signing mechanism on some of our distributed images, or two things that we looked at additionally. I have looked at SBOM formats. It's still a little bit unclear to me what the end user utilization of those are. I'll take a look. Thanks.
Any more questions about the Cloud Custodian review or the project itself? All right, if not, thank you very much. The review was very extensive. I think you know, both the Cloud Custodian team as well as the reviewers did a good job. That was like really when I think beyond what was asked, just going deep into, you know, the different cases and the different scenarios of which you consider the exposure and the risk of using Cloud Custodian. So I know there were some things that may need to be edited in the document. So let's Kapil, George, Robert, you know, let's create a PR if necessary, so we can get that in. We'll be bringing some of the recommendations to the CNCF to the talk during the talk liaison meeting. And I think one request is usually what we do is for the review recommendations for review for the security recommendations that have some kind of actionable response, usually we create an issue in the repo just to track it, just to make sure, you know, it doesn't go away, or when we do another review a year down the road, we want to see, you know, what's the status of this, in case, you know, this comes up again in you know, graduation or something.
Custodian's repo, not stack.
Yeah, custodian's repo. Sorry.
Yeah, I'll go through it again. I don't think there was anything that would rise to the level of a GitHub issue. you know, with a concrete risk and a concrete proposed solution. I think they were more, again, resourcing process or, you know, suggestions. But George Kapil, if I, you know, there's something in there that you feel we should elevate to a GitHub issue. Let me know, but I'll go through it and review it again.
I think when I was looking at it, they were like, let me take a look at that again.
If there are resource specific issues, it is highly recommended that you create a GitHub issue on the project link. That way, when you go to request those resources from the CNCF, they can show that there's a line between the issue and the corresponding security review. So they understand a little bit more of the background of where those requests are coming from.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah. So I think if maybe some of this can be consolidated into like one issue with sub bullet points.
Yeah, but I think there was two callouts I thought I saw, and I didn't probably should read the doc. Where is the notion of some default guidance around a role, I think, which I think we can cover in the documentation. And then their request, the notion around fuzzing or taking advantage of fuzzing resources. We did actually engage with the team that I think CNCF has engaged around fuzzing, and we did get a PR up. It wasn't clear. There was a little bit of unclarity about what it was actually doing for us in this context, but yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, let's try and get the issues up. Like Emily said, you know, to reference to when we bring this to the top and the CNCF for resources, as well as, you know, some things that, you know, further down the road, when Caucus student goes for graduation, TOC is going to come to us and be like, so what's happening with all these, right? So we at least have a way to engage in. And,
we'll be looking for those issues and to see progress on them.
Yeah. I guess that's where I'd ask for a little clarity on if the issue is CNCF, give us money so we can do a code audit. There won't be any progress until the CNCF approves that. So
yep.
Is that something you really want it to be ticketed, or?
I think that, yeah. I think having the ticket to track the need for it is good. And I believe that when you go to put in the request, because as part of graduation, it's been a while, I have to read through the documentation, you can request assistance in getting a security audit for the project. But I'm not 100%.
And usually, I think so far with some of the projects, the TOC, unless it's like very clear cut, the TOC has sometimes asked the TAC to do an initial assessment first as well. Do you have your hand up, Josh?
Sorry, I couldn't find the put the hand up button. It was my understanding from just reading it recently that the audit was a requirement for graduation.
So the audit is, it's about whether or not it's independent from the CNCF and the project, or a company goes in and pays for it. So that's really kind of the question there. So having the issue, okay, no matter what, is important, because we've made the recommendation, like the security tag has made the recommendation that a formal audit be conducted. Here's the issue reflecting that. Somebody help us, give us resources to do that.
Okay. Understood. Thank you.
Awesome. So if there's no more questions, then thank you again, Josh, Kapil, Robert, Emily, and the rest of the team that was involved in the review. This was awesome. And so it's a document that I'm going to take a closer look at as well. If not, we'll end 10 minutes early. Just a quick heads up. Next week is going to be our check-in meetings, or now we're officially making like triage meetings, which seem to be very productive. So if you're interested in, you know, knowing a bit more about how triage is done, getting a bit more involved with issue resolution, all work streams in the tag, drop by. If not, take a week off. Cool. Thanks, everyone.
Have a good day, everyone.
See you.